Take that with you with Follow-On Damaris back in Studio 41, sponsored by NTTA. I'm Damaris. That is Mark Followell.
Yeah, good to see you. I don't have to look at your unmade hotel room bed in the background.
That's
now.
Right. I should have brought it with me just so you can have it. It is Eclipse Day. We're going to get into that right off the top. Once this drops, it'll be over with, but we are recording this in the morning, and I know you're going to dash on the tollway back home before you have to take off for Charlotte. And our good friends at NTTA will get you there.
Yeah, they're going to make it really easy on the toll road. You know, they're putting signs on there, flashing on there. Don't stop on the highway to view the eclipse. Even if you have a toll tag. Even if you have a MAVS toll tag, don't stop on the highway to view the eclipse. But if you do have a MAVS toll tag, it's a great thing. Because if you put it front and center on your windshield, it cuts your toll bill in half. You show what a big MFFL you are. And it has these awesome colors to it. It's just $19.99. At getmytolltag.com, small sticker, big savings.
So you're telling me that signs are necessary
to
tell
big,
people.
The big electronic, the big LED signs that are over the roadway.
Tell people not to stop on a major thoroughfare to watch the eclipse.
Yeah, I feel like signs
don't
aren't
necessary.
Don't
put your glasses on.
Right, yeah. That might be hard to drive with your eclipse glasses on.
Okay, give us the latest. We drove in here, and it is cloudy after many days of beautiful weather.
Which is so frustrating. And unfortunately, my plan of buying up all the giant oscillating box fans from local Targets and Walmarts and then putting them on high and aiming them at the clouds, probably not going to work.
Okay.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's not going to help. What the Weather Service is saying, and again, when this drops, it'll be later on Monday, and we'll all know what we did or didn't get to see. So I'm hoping. But what the Weather Service has said is this time right now, it's 10:27 as we're recording. So between 9 and 11 is the worst time of day. This is when this low cloud deck is going to be here. The hope is the low cloud deck is going to start burning off and we'll be left with high clouds, a layer of high clouds with some breaks. And where the breaks might be and where the breaks might be in the low cloud deck, and where, how thick or thin the high clouds might be, it's all kind of up in the air. We don't know. But there is at least moderate hope of moderate visibility. It's certainly not going to be any sort of optimal visibility situation, but there is at least hope that you'll be able to see features of the eclipse. I think what we all want to see is it go dark and see the corona for 3 minutes and 40 seconds.
So you're not concerned with the starting of the partial, which I guess starts at 12:23. You've been there, done that.
We've seen partial eclipses before. Yes, if it's cloudy at 12:23, that's not going to be the end of the world.
Gotcha.
Just get out of my sky by 1:42.
1:42 is the time. Okay,
that's
when that's when Followell will be in the Followell backyard.
Yeah,
with his glasses.
Yes, exactly. Well, you don't need your glasses though once you go to totality.
Okay.
So that's
really?
Yeah, you can look at it. That's what's so amazing is you can look at it and the.
Are you sure about that?
Yes, you can. Yes, absolutely.
I don't want to put bad info out there.
You can look in the 3 minutes and 40 seconds.
So it'll be dark
totality.
At that point, and all we'll see is the corona.
The corona
is that
of
what
the
you're
sun.
Saying?
Yeah.
And it'll be like nighttime.
Yes, correct. It's going to be.
How will your greyhounds handle that?
I don't know. I mean, that's They're what's so interesting
crazy.
Is what are what you know. I think that's what the fascinating thing about total eclipses are is what happens with birds, you know, and other animals. You start like, you know, does their circadian rhythm, basically, their instinctual rhythm start preparing to go to sleep.
Are you going
to
start howling?
No, my voice won't allow me to howl right now. There's no howling after what's happened the last 4 days.
So does it get progressively dark as the eclipse happens? And
yeah,
then
sure.
It's total
well,
darkness?
Sure. Like any, I mean, any time that an eclipse happens, I mean, you know, obviously there's less light in the sky, and so it's just going to be less and less and less until we get to that 3 minutes and 40 seconds where the corona of the sun is.
Okay, so the Followell Weather Center has been busy.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Every day. It's been very busy.
You've been checking multiple sites, multiple apps.
Yeah, mostly the National Weather Service. The National Weather Service.
You pay for a weather app, right?
I pay for a radar app. Not a weather app, a radar app. Let's get it right. The National Weather Service and our good buddy Pete Delkus, who's on WFAA, which of course is the flagship station of the Dallas Mavericks Broadcast
Network.
Have you
been communicating with Pete Delkus or Junior Miller?
I have not, no.
Okay, you've leaving them alone.
We did shout out Pete, though, Friday night during the Mavs Golden State broadcast, which of course was on WFAA and around the state on the Dallas Mavericks Broadcast Network.
Well, let's get to the Mavs. Let's get to the latest. Let's do standings right up off the top. Where are the Mavs as we speak? And there they are in fifth, still mathematically not guaranteed a top six spot. But
Correct.
The numbers are starting to come into focus. If they win two of their next four, and oh, by the way, two of those four are against Charlotte and Detroit.
Right.
Tuesday and Friday.
Right.
They are guaranteed the fifth spot.
Yes, if they win two games, they're guaranteed the fifth spot.
No matter what anybody else does.
Correct. Correct. Because they win a two-way tiebreaker with Phoenix. They win a two-way tiebreaker with New Orleans. They win a three-way tiebreak with Phoenix and New Orleans because the Mavericks, in any case, if they tie New Orleans, they would be the division champ.
Okay.
The Mavs are going to win the Southwest Division unless New Orleans outright passes them, which is pretty remote.
Very unlikely.
Yeah, could happen, but now, very unlikely.
Two games behind the Clippers, you don't own that tiebreaker. It's mathematically possible, but unlikely you could get to fourth.
Correct. Yeah, that's
but
exactly right.
We're not mathematically eliminated from fourth yet. Sixth takes one win and a New Orleans or Phoenix loss.
Correct.
At any point in during the rest of the regular season.
That's correct.
To get sixth.
Correct.
So if we win one game and go 1-3 down the stretch and either of those teams lose one of their games and don't go undefeated, we're the sixth seed. So sixth seed is extremely, extremely, you know, looks like a floor there.
Yeah, correct. That is
correct. And both teams play tomorrow. One plays Portland.
That's New Orleans. They're playing in Portland, and the Suns play a home game with the Clippers, and then the next night they go to L.A. and play a road game with the Clippers.
Okay, so it is possible by the end of the night tomorrow after the Charlotte game, if the Mavs win and one of those teams loses, we can rest next week and not be in the play-in.
Yeah, and the other thing that's really interesting too, by the way, is that the other adding confusion to all of this is that you don't know where the losses are going to come from behind you in these unique games of the Suns and the Kings are going to play. The Kings and the Pelicans still have to play each other. Yesterday, the Pelicans beat the Suns, so you know you knew one team behind you was going to win and one team behind you was going to lose. The Lakers and Pelicans play each other. The Lakers and Warriors play each other.
Well, the good news is you have the tiebreaker on the Suns and the Pels, most likely against the Kings, right?
That one's still very much up in the air because of conference record,
Lakers, you own it.
Yep.
So
Warriors, well, the Warriors can't tell you. The best the Warriors can do at this point is 47. The worst the Mavs can do is
48.
So the
Mavs are in good shape for 5 or 6. It looks like 5 is a very real possibility. My question for you is, if you're, you know, the Mavs, are you just continuing to try to win every game on your schedule until you're locked into a seed? Are you doing any kind of positioning to get a matchup that you desire?
No, I just don't think there's going to really be much of a chance to do that. I mean, I guess we'll see on the last day of the season. This is how I would manage the week is, you know, I would be doing the best I can in Charlotte because, you know, you want to get that win. You know, who knows what they're going to do? This is just Mark Folwell's vision for what he would do. Go win in Charlotte, play your guys.
As poor of an idea as it would be to put you in charge,
it would be a disastrously bad idea. Go win your games in Charlotte. Go second out of a back-to-back. Rest key people in Miami. Play your last home game to the fullest of extent. Have the guys out there for your fans and. Hopefully you won't have to, like, have a heavy exertion night in that game against Detroit. And then I would assume you feel this way, being very, very badly scarred from what happened in the finale of the regular season in 2022 and Luka hurting his calf in a game that technically the Mavs could have moved up, but they didn't control their own destiny. They could have gone from 4-3. So they played it out, and then Luka got hurt in the third quarter of that game.
Yeah, I called it with you.
Yeah, so don't play anybody in Oklahoma City on Sunday.
So Oklahoma City obviously may still have something to play for. The argument against trying to position is you have no idea where these top three seeds are going to land.
Yeah, I mean, look how close they are. 54-24, 54-24, 53-25.
So Oklahoma City could very easily have something to play for, and the Mavs could very easily on Sunday be locked in.
Yeah, exactly. I think they probably will be locked in on Sunday.
And so I agree. I don't know that positioning does you a lot of good because you don't know where you're going to end up. And it could be very likely that we're now going to see the Clippers for the third time in 5 years. The good news is you're going to get a week off.
Correct.
The playoffs start Saturday or Sunday, the 20th or the 21st.
Right.
And
when you're not in the play-in tournament, while there's no guarantee of this, but because, you know,
Friday.
7 and 8 are being determined. Well, you know the 8 seed plays on Sunday because the 8 seed isn't determined until Friday. the seven seeds get determined, you know, on Tuesday or Wednesday. I don't remember what the schedule is for that. But so there's a chance that maybe, you know, a seven seed can play on the 2-7 can start on Saturday. But the reality is, if you're in the 4-5 or the 3-6 brackets where you know who you're playing, there's no mystery to it, those games probably will be on Saturday.
Okay.
No guarantee, of course. I mean, it could get pushed to Sunday, but I would say there would be a pretty significant chance it would start as a late Saturday game out in LA.
So we're not going to do a traditional game-by-game breakdown of the week. We're going to kind of talk a little bit more big picture of how the Mavs got here, because the scuttlebutt nationally is this is the team no one wants to face.
Yes. The Mavs have now won 14 of the last 16 games and have shot from 8th to on the cusp of securing 5th.
So how did we get here from Indiana on February 6th or March 6th?
Yeah, March 5th, the Indiana game, and then the streak started March the 7th. Yeah, we recorded a podcast on March the 6th where the world was crumbling.
Right. How do we get here? And I think there's a number of ways, and we're going to break that all down through the course of today. And it has to start with, I think, the iconic image of the season, really.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is, and great job by the Bally Sports crew of capturing Luka and Kyrie at ultimate exhaustion and pain, walking off the court together.
Luka has this little just layup at the end, and then
there it is.
The Luka-I chemistry. So I said here that, and as you saw in the rundown when I emailed it, I said, trust me on this, that Luka and Kyrie are the Archimedes of the NBA.
Yeah, I didn't even look it up. I just
Do you know who Archimedes is?
I'm gonna.
You should know this, by the way, Mr. Greece.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. The ancient third century, one of the great ancient world mathematicians, scientists, physicists, and such. Archimedes said, "Give me a lever long enough and a fulcrum on which to place it, and I can move the world." And the lever and fulcrum of the Mavericks team that's moving the basketball world and moving their world anyway.
That's
Luka and Kyrie.
There's the shot right there. I mean, look at where we were a year ago.
Yeah.
This team was, April 9th was the last game of the year last year.
Yeah.
This team was 5-13 in clutch games after the trade deadline. Everybody was saying it's not going to work.
Yeah.
And now you're looking at.
It gives me goosebumps to see that. Like DJ Jones getting that shot there and then Kyrie calling everybody.
It started with those two.
Yeah.
Because they are, as you say, the fulcrum. They are
the lever in the fulcrum.
As I said in my very first article in D Magazine, my season preview that dropped the morning of game one, we go as far as those two take us.
Correct. Yeah.
But you need what's around you, and we're going to talk about all that as well. And then what happened was after these two, you get the group effort, right? Yeah. You get then the team coming in. Luka's in pain. He's exhausted. He said, "I'm tired," to Kyrie. Kyrie talked to Skin afterwards and said, "I'm depleted." They put everything out there to get this win in a game they could have easily punted when they were down 22 early in this game.
God, that's such a great video. That is so amazing, man. That is such togetherness. That is such what a team is all about, man.
And what's interesting about what they're doing when they're both playing at this level and they combine, this is the most combined points they've had as Mavericks.
Yep, 85.
Defenses don't know what to do.
Right.
They're befuddled.
Yeah, because normally teams are doubling Luka, but yesterday Houston had to start doubling Kyrie. I mean, they double him on one possession in the logo circle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you double, then you're playing advantage basketball. And Luka said it over and over, "I want to play advantage basketball." Why wouldn't you?
Yep.
If you go single, Kyrie said it last night after the game, "I'm going to cook." And so is Luka.
He cooked yesterday.
And if you just try to switch, we're going to find the mismatch.
Yeah.
Literally, defenses don't know what to do when you have these two kinds of players. And I talked about it earlier. This is why he's the perfect partner and not a big man for Luka in terms of what your other superstar should be.
Right.
Because you have that ability to play 48 minutes with the superstar in the court. Obviously, open and close games with those guys together. And we're finally seeing the two of them. You know, the chemistry is there. The trust is there. These are the buzzwords you're hearing over and over again that Luka said 2 years ago, this is the key to winning.
Chemistry and trust.
And the organization listened.
Yeah.
And it's working. And
I mean, as Kyrie said in his interview with Skin yesterday after the game, sometimes, you know, you just, after a game like that, you just want to hug your brother. And it just it just gives you all the feels to see the love, appreciation, respect, chemistry and trust as well. But there's just so many positive vibes and words that you can use to characterize the relationship between the two, whether it's as teammates or as basketball players.
And as leaders,
yeah,
on and off the court. They know where their roles are. Everybody knows how to play. I mean, Daniel Gafford and Maxey talked about being in awe of their teammates, and and it lifts them up to play even better when you're around that kind of greatness. So the Lukai, as you termed, chemistry is off the charts. And then Luka himself is playing at, we've talked about this over and over again, but we've got a week. By the way, Mark Stein, and I was on Mark Stein's great radio program Saturday, which is available on podcast form if you look up Saturday Steinline on your podcast app, broke that as of Saturday, MVP ballots had not been sent out, because I know you had a concern that there was early voting.
Correct, yeah.
So that's good news.
In the old days, the ballots were sent out. They would already have been sent out. And it's not like that there was anything nefarious going on in terms of encouraging you to turn things in. It's just like a teacher would tell you, especially when you're doing things online, turn things in early because you don't want to get to the last minute and then all of a sudden have a technical problem, you know, or computer problem, or whatever.
I find that concerning when it's a regular season award and all the regular seasons hadn't been played and they're saying turn it in early.
They're not saying turn it in early. They're saying feel free to turn it. Feel free to do so. Don't miss out. Don't miss the deadline. Don't wait till the last minute. That sort of thing.
So that's
interesting that the ballots haven't been sent out yet.
As of Saturday.
As of Saturday. Okay.
So that's good news, because now you're seeing, you know, the Mavs are putting a campaign together. This Pravi MVP campaign is now out there. And if you don't know what that means, go research it. That's kind of the point of that campaign.
Right.
They don't want to fully explain what that means.
Right.
So, the Mavs are going to start wearing Pravi MVP shirts soon. You know, Luka's behind this. Luka's not behind this. Luka, you know, is
he's comfortable with. He's okay with the.
Well, he's okay with it. I don't know. I assume he's okay. When I say he's behind it, he's the reason for it. Like his play is promoting this, and so let's go through.
What
we're seeing.
Our buddy Bob Sturm on the Ticket, you and I are great friends with him and respect what he does. I mean, he has said, and I think he said it perfectly, Luka is the MVP. He may not win the award, but Luka is the MVP. And all of these things are just, you know, part of the argument. But I think the remarkable historical nature of the season is what you have to examine here. Points created is your own points plus the points that you generate through assist. This 57.3 number that he's at is beating out James Harden's 56 in a year with the Rockets as the most in the play-by-play era. And to be honest with you, Brian, even though no stats database service can fully accurately research it pre-1996, I'm pretty sure this is the most ever, because I just kind of by common sense, well, I looked at Wilt. And Wilt averaged 50 points a game one year, but he only averaged about 2.5 assists. So that's only 5 points, because there was no three-pointer, obviously, when Wilt played. And Tiny Archibald averaged over 34 points per game one year and led the league. He led the league in scoring and assists playing with Kansas City in 1972-73. But his 11 assists, his 11.4 assists, whatever it was, would only account for 22.8, so it was 56.8 would be the points that he would have created.
So you're saying
created.
That 57.3 is the most in
most
25
likely.
Years,
yeah.
At least.
Most likely in the history of the league.
History of the league, okay.
Combined points, rebounds, and assists. This is the most since Kareem had 56 combined point rebounds and assists in his MVP season of 71-72. As long as Luka stays over 52.7, which was Westbrook in 16-17. He's going to be the seventh player ever to be in the top 20 in points, rebounds, assists, and steals per game. He's hovering right around the top 15 in rebounds. He's 16th as we speak today. We'll see if he ends up getting into the top 15, which would even make the group of people to do that even smaller. But at a minimum, the seventh player ever to be in the top 20 in points, rebounds, assists, and steals per game. Almost 34 points per game. It certainly looks like he's going to end up with the 20th best points per game season in the entire history of the league, with a lot of Wilt years out in front of him and some Jordan years and some Kobe years and things like that. Kareem, you know, I mean, Elgin Baylor, we're talking about the true greats of the game are the only people who've had one season or multiple seasons scoring more than that. as you look at some highlights and what Luka did yesterday as he scored 37 points in that game. One other thing you saw on the bottom of that graphic a moment ago was that the team's record is 44-24 when he plays. They're winning 65% of the games when Luka plays. And team record is, you know, we have been banging the drum forever on the precedent has been set for a 47-win, sixth-place team with Russell Westbrook, the Thunder, for him to win the MVP. That was in 2017. And for a 48-win, sixth-seeded Denver Nuggets team to win the MVP, Nikola Jokic, in 2021.
You're looking at likely a 50-win, fifth-seed Maverick team.
Yes.
At least.
So the team record thing is out the window. And if anybody is making a decision to vote because, oh, well, you know, Luka and Dallas only won 50 and Denver's going to win 56 or 57, what are we doing? Are we going to, like, take all of this history and basically say, well, no, those seven wins, man, you know, which is basically the difference between being, what, winning 65% of your games and 70% of your games or 72% of your games or whatever. I haven't exactly run the perfect percentages on that, but you get the drift. Are we really going to make a decision based on the difference between five or six wins over an 82-game season? That does matter for playoff seeding, but I think in this kind of picture, Luka has now, and the Mavericks, have checked the box for sufficient team success.
Sometimes we can overthink things.
Yeah.
Sometimes narratives take hold. Sometimes the hard looks easy. And sometimes we take things for granted.
Which is what Luka, I mean, he makes the hard look easy.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
And we take it for granted. This, if he doesn't win or even is as the straw poll of likely voters was getting one first place vote, people are going to look back and go, what were we thinking?
Yeah.
Years from now.
Right.
And it's going to be like when Shakespeare in Love won over Saving Private Ryan. Which I know you're just going to give me a blank stare because you haven't seen either. But
I've seen Saving Private Ryan. Yes.
But, you know, this is what we're looking at. And, yes, we obviously have a drum to beat with here. And, again, I take nothing away from Shai Gilgeous-Alexander or Jokic.
They're phenomenal worthy. Players.
And
yes, they are going to be first team.
These arguments
NBA
are
as they should.
Tearing one down to build another. That is not how you do this. But looking at what Luka has done is pretty remarkable.
Yes, it's remarkable. It's historic.
Yes.
That's the thing. It is historic in terms of he's going to be in a class by himself or standing with a very, very small number of players in terms of these achievements. And so that's why it, to me, is just, it's indisputably an MVP caliber season. And he's the MVP. He may not win it based on the 100 people who vote, but he is the MVP of this league based on what's happened this year.
So the other half of this equation is Kyrie Irving, the Robin to Batman, as I forgot, did Luka say that?
Luka said Kyrie's Batman and he's Robin.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what Luka said after.
Well, I like that he said that.
Yeah, that was after the Sacramento game on the road trip, the TNT Sacramento game, I think.
And so the new term that is being thrown around that I hear is 4Q Kai or 4QK.
Yeah, okay.
And I don't know which of those you prefer, but
I like 4QK. That's cool. Yeah,
but
that's
what he is doing in the fourth quarter, as you put there, is a masterclass.
Yeah.
He had 19 points, the most by a Maverick in the fourth quarter this season.
Mm-hmm.
He leads the league in fourth quarter scoring. I talked to him on radio during the road trip about his mindset going in these fourth quarters. He said, you know, I want to give Luka a break. This is my time to be aggressive. The defenses are like that. I'm going to go attack the basket and get us over the finish line. And last night, he was absolutely masterful again. 25 points in the fourth quarter and overtime. And it's just, you know, that's his time to go. And when you have what Luka is able to do throughout the game and then have Kyrie throughout the game, but especially in the fourth, be able to just be that closer, you know, you just had a feeling, and I really did. I don't know if you did as well last night, that the Mavs were never out of that game.
Yeah, certainly had a feeling the Mavs were never out of it. I mean, to Houston's credit, in the fourth quarter, they had some great responses to things that Kyrie was doing and things that the Mavericks were doing. But it's just, it sometimes really is sitting over there doing the broadcast. It's like pinch yourself stuff, man, that Kyrie Irving is here and part of the Mavericks and doing his thing at a very high level and so comfortable here, so revered and respected here, and I've said this all along from the minute Kyrie showed up on the scene, I stress this. Kyrie Irving, I've watched this for many, many years. He is immensely respected in NBA player and coach circles, and you can see that in every game when he wasn't on this team. Now you get to see him interacting with everybody after every game. In the past, I would just see Maverick players, or sometimes if you watch a game on TV or something like that, you would see people interact with him. But the respect that he has of this team, and I want to discuss some leadership things. We'll hit that later on, of course, Brian, related to some things that have happened over the course of the last week. But his game stands on business, man. He does as a person, and his game does. And by the way, as of today, in his time with the Mavs, Brian, this is, you know, it's funny. He's probably not going to be 50, 40, 90 in either season individually.
But he's so close.
But his collective time with the Mavs is now, as of today, 50, 40, 90.
Yeah, he's 49.6 this year in shooting overall. Yeah. That's the only reason he's not 50, 40, 90 this year.
His Mavericks 76-game run is 50, 40, 90. 50 exactly on the field goal percentage, 40.5 on the three, 92% on free throw. Did you hear the note I mentioned on the telecast during the fourth quarter yesterday when he was at the free throw line?
Don't remember.
95 out of 100 in his time with the Mavericks on fourth quarter free throw attempts. That is one of the most insane stats.
Yeah, you just feel very comfortable
yeah.
when he's there. And he went to the line. The team went
times.
To the line. Yeah. 45 times yeah. last night, hit 40 of them. And again, you needed every one of those practically yeah. to get into overtime.
Houston,
and he was 15 of 17.
Look, in that game yesterday, and I pointed this out in the second quarter when the Mavs were down 15, and I said, this could be a lot worse. One thing that Houston does, and they do play better defense this year, but they foul a lot.
Yes.
They foul a lot.
They're over-aggressive.
Man. Yes. And their opponents take the second most free throws in the NBA. And so, yeah, there's a lot of, they commit a lot of fouls. That kept the Mavs in the game, and then obviously Kyrie went to the line among many others, you know, at important stages in the fourth quarter, but it kept them in the game in the first half because 27 of the 45 free throws the Mavs had yesterday were in the first half.
So we've talked about the superstars.
Yeah.
It's a team effort, and one of the biggest reasons of this turnaround since the trade deadline, I had a high-ranking person in the Mavs say, track defense since the trade.
Right.
Season-long stats, you can almost throw out the window. This is a
truly
completely
yeah.
different team.
Mm-hmm.
You can track it since the trade, and you can track it since that Indiana game.
Mm-hmm.
And so this defense has really led the way. Here are the numbers. Since the trade, they're overall seventh in defense.
Correct. And we're talking defensive rating when we say, oh, you know, seventh in defense.
The Falwell theorem is, of course, top 10 in offense, top 10 in defense. That's what championship teams do.
Right.
There are very few teams, I did the spreadsheet, I don't have it in front of me, but there are very few teams that have been not in the top 10 in one of those categories that have won the title.
Yes, and a lot of times when they are, they're like 11th or 12th or
yeah.
13th.
The
or
only outlier,
like
I think, was the Lakers in like 02 when they were 21st in defense, but
yeah.
they had Kobe and Shaq. And
yeah, I think that the Detroit championship team was low in offense back in 04 too.
So since the trade, 7th in blocks, 7th in opponent's point in the paint.
There you go.
Remember the layup line that this team was
yeah.
beforehand.
Whenever Derek Lively, at least whenever Derek Lively wasn't playing. Yeah.
Exactly. But yeah. look at the Toronto game,
yeah.
Pascal Siakam,
yeah.
what Sabonis was able to do.
Yeah.
Since March 6th, which is the day after that Indiana loss,
right.
and that team meeting, they are overall first in defense.
Mm-hmm.
Number one.
Yep. Defensive rating, I think, is like 106.5, 106.5.
Defensive rebounding, second. Blocks, fifth. Opponent points in the paint, fourth.
It's been fantastic, man. And I bet opponent paint field goal percentage, at least going into yesterday, I mentioned this in the telecast, it's been first since, hold on 1 second, let me turn my notes over from yesterday and not spill my hot tea. Opponent paint field goal percentage since the trades is first, going into yesterday anyway. You know, opponents are only shooting 52.8% of the paint. The
yeah.
league average is 57.
And it's not just
yeah.
the blocks. It's the shot adjustments. It's
yeah.
it's packing that paint, making it a lot harder.
I didn't ask for this in our video package, but blocks don't always come in the paint, by the way. How about Derrick Jones Jr. blocking three jump shots the other night in the game against Golden
Luka
State?
Luka did it last night.
Yeah, yeah. That was Yeah, and as Jay Kidd pointed out in his pregame media availability yesterday, Jones blocking Steph Curry. I mean, he said, I don't know the last time Steph Curry got a jump shot blocked.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's he went into the starting lineup, but obviously a lot of the defensive attention and the defensive improvement is I feel like, centered on Gafford and Washington, and of course they deserve their flowers. But DJ going back into the starting lineup is a big part of it, too. It improved point of attack defense. We said at the time you would lose some things on offense, but, I mean, Josh Green got hurt anyway, so you were probably going to have to do this, even if you hadn't. But point of attack defense would get better, and it has gotten better. And he's just he's a fun player to watch, just this very selfless glue guy type of dude.
The starting lineup's 13-1 without when Luka plays since they changed it. And you're right, Washington is playing tremendous on-ball defense, switching 1 through 5. Gafford and Lively inside. Exum is playing great defense with his length.
Yeah,
Hardaway as well. Your two superstars are playing effectively. Obviously, you mentioned how Luke is in the top 20 in steals. It's looking like a maybe even better version of the defense we saw 2 years ago in the playoffs.
Yes.
Where they're locked in, they know what they're supposed to do, they're clicking on all cylinders.
Well, there's interior defense now. That's what makes it a different deal.
With Dodo improved and perimeter defense, too.
Dodo and Reggie were so great in the playoff run in 2022, but, you know, that whole thing was, run them off the three-point line, force long twos, and, you know, we're going to concede rebounds, and we're not going to rebound very well on most nights. And we're going to, you know, as you said, we got to win the 3-versus-2 battle, the turnover battle. It's not like that anymore. There doesn't have to be anything gimmicky.
They're feeding players to the rim so that the big boys can take it. That's the philosophy that they want to do. And you're right. And now, remember, issue in that playoff series was Dodo and Reggie were playing over 45 minutes a game.
Yeah, it's crazy.
You have different people you can rotate in and out of now.
Yeah, yeah. Let's hope that from the defensive perspective, that you get Lively healthy by the time
he's off crutches.
Yeah, that's great. You hope that he's ready to go by the time the playoffs start. Maybe Josh plays. I mean, I think it sounds like Kidd is cautiously optimistic that Josh would make an appearance this week before the end of the regular season, 1 or 2 games. So that would be really good. Because he certainly helps defense, energy, et cetera. And then I don't anticipate Lively playing before the end of the year, but get that 5 or 6, and you got a week off.
So this last play here versus Golden State really was indicative of – I just thought that the scheme that Jason Kidd put in and the fact that Kyrie didn't even guard the inbounds pass. He's going back and forth between Paul. They trap Curry. The closeout by Exum, the closeout by Jones – that was just brilliant defense to let a team that has done this over and over, a championship team, not even get a clean look, right? He has no chance. P.J. Washington cutting off that pass, that driving lane, just that was brilliant.
It was great.
Across all aspects of it, to not even let them get any kind of look and switching everything, having those kinds of long athletic players to make that happen, that was indicative of what this team is capable of doing defensively. And when you add that kind of defense, and they've said it over and over, to what they know they can do offensively, and now they're playing with pace, and now they're rebounding, and now they're rim protecting, that's why this team is being talked about as the team that no one wants to play.
Hey, man, I'm so glad you brought this play up. It's fun to watch it, and it's one of about 4 late-game situations over the weekend because there was this defensive sequence, what we'll look at later, the offensive play that led to the P.J. Washington go-ahead layup yesterday. It didn't result in a made shot, but they ran a hell of an out-of-bounds play to get Kyrie's tying 3-point attempt with 20 seconds left in regulation.
Yeah, the ATOs have been on point.
And then to be able to grab the rebound leading to the Exum shot to tie the game against Houston. That was executed very well, and that was not an out-of-timeout. But that's obviously, as you know, Brian, from watching shoot-arounds and practices over the years, these are things that you work on throughout the course of the season. What are you going to do if we rebound a ball off a missed free throw and have, under 10 seconds and don't have a timeout? How are you going to approach this? So major boxes checked in terms of late game defensive and offensive execution, but to this specific point, defensively, great out of timeout, great during the flow of the game, and great numbers that you brought up. Seventh again since the trades, and first since March 7th.
One quick note to go to the Falwell theorem of top 10. Since just before the trade on February 5th, this team in offense is 4th, 7th in defense. Their net rating is 2nd.
Wow, that's awesome, man.
That makes you happy.
Yes, it does. Yeah.
And remember, that Golden State game was no Luka, and they were still able to play a full-strength Golden State team that has something to play for and beat them. And the reason is because, as you say, it takes a village.
Yes,
and it takes everybody else.
It does, man.
To win, to get there. And you saw key plays by – you call key performances. I thought it was P.J. Washington's game Friday night.
Oh, his best game.
Best game by far as a Maverick.
There's no debate. Now, obviously, he's had some great defensive efforts. I mean, we get sucked in by the points, of course, but that's understandable. And you're not going to win the game if he doesn't score 32 points.
Right.
And, by the way, five steals and two blocks. P.J. joins Mark Aguirre in 1987 as the only Maverick players ever to have a stat line in a game of at least 30 points, at least five steals, and at least two blocks. And we're seeing some highlights right now. Again, as always.
And don't forget the five rebounds. Did you mention that?
I did not mention that. But
he's
that's
been
a great
rebounding
part of it.
Really, really well.
Yes,
as well.
He has. 13 yesterday. If you're watching on YouTube, you're seeing the highlights right now of PJ's game against Golden State. If you're listening on Spotify or iTunes or wherever, great to have you with us. But a reminder that you can see some awesome graphics and videos when you consume the podcast via YouTube. Washington was incredible. It is so great to see PJ's confidence back in his outside shot, because I think that's opened up for things for him inside.
It changes everything.
Yeah. As we have said all along, and coincidentally, as we get ready to play Charlotte tomorrow night and Grant Williams, no knock on Grant, but I think that everybody looked at that trade. Well, most everybody. I saw our buddy John Hollinger yesterday, and I like John, and we get along really well, and we talked a little bit about this.
Did you give him a little grief?
I wouldn't say grief, but whenever we were talking about how the team was playing, I just kind of casually said, well, this is why the deal with Washington was such an upgrade over Grant Williams. And I didn't say, unlike what you said. Because, no, I really love John. He's a great guy.
And it's not him specifically, but there were other. I talked to a national pundit face-to-face in New York when I was calling the game on radio the night of that trade.
Yeah.
And he was like, you don't give up a pick swap for a backup center like Gafford, and you don't. And they just couldn't see the forest from the trees about why, what this team did to its versatility, athleticism, the fear-based thinking that if you're going to need that pick swap in 28 because Luka's not here, and that's how you have to think about it as a GM. And that's the opposite of how you think as a GM. Like, and there were a lot of people who thought that way, and so yes, I think there are a lot of people who are going, wow, I didn't expect this because. We're going to get into the front office acumen here in a bit, but that's what you do as a front office. You look for the gems that you think in my scheme and in my system with my personnel, they're underutilized assets that I can sprout.
He's versatile as a defender, and he's versatile as an offensive player. The offensive versatility I always felt like I saw and knew was there. The defensive versatility, I have to say, is something that I did not see and did not expect. But the offensive versatility is something that always has been there, from his ability to make passes and create for other people, from his ability to handle the ball, from his inside game, his around the basket game, offensive rebounds and putbacks, little push shots in the paint, and obviously being able to be a reliable three-point shooter, which at the beginning was pretty rough. But going into yesterday, Brian, PJ over the last seven games was shooting 47% on his three-pointers.
In his last three, he's 12 of 23.
Yeah, it took a little hit yesterday with the 2-for-7, but certainly his two threes he made yesterday were very, very well-timed. And then, of course, the other component of the trades, the trade on February the 8th on deadline day, was Daniel Gafford. And Daniel Gafford's contribution was equally as significant as PJ's on Friday night in Dallas's hard-fought 108-106 win over Golden State, because Gafford was great on the glass. He really helped them make up some of the ground after they weren't rebounding the ball well early in the game. Gaff had 15 rebounds. He had 10 points. He had 5 assists. It's the third time, Brian, in the last 3 weeks that Gafford's had 5 and assists a game, tying his career high. Oh, and he had more paint protection with 3 blocks. And Dirk, J-Ho, Popeye Jones, Roy Tarpley, Lorenzo Williams, I might be leaving somebody off the list, but it's a pretty short list of Maverick players who have ever equaled that stat line in a game that Daniel Gafford had from Friday night.
You go back to 2 years ago in the Western Conference Finals, you saw cutting by the Warriors. They're so good at ball and body movement. You saw constant cutting to the rim, mm-hmm. Looney, Klay Thompson, yeah. Green, all those guys. That's why he was key in helping take that away.
Kevon Looney was so good in the Western Conference Finals, the Mavs felt like, well, we got to go out and get somebody big. We got to go sign JaVale McGee, and we see how that turned out. So
yeah, and oh, by the way, how important is he without Lively in there? Like, if you don't make that deal and Lively's hurt, then you're back to the no rim protection layup line
yep.
inside. So, and oh, by the way, it's not just those two. Although, again, those are your two new acquisitions and their starters. But Exum, who I call the connector, mm-hmm. but we can also start calling him the closer because he has absolutely fearless. He is now 8 of 12 in clutch three-point shooting.
Yep, you're seeing some highlights right now of his game yesterday. Dante had 14 points and 9 rebounds. And by the way, with no Luka and he had to increase his playmaking abilities the other night, 7 assists and 11 points in the Golden State game. This, of course, you're seeing right now is the first look you'll get. We'll have some more in a minute of the three-pointer that Exum hit yesterday to tie the game. It sent the arena into a frenzy, the broadcast into a frenzy. An amazing call by Harp with the ball in midair when he said, got it. Our broadcast position is so online from where Dante shot the three. We're standing like right behind him. We had a great look. It was obviously, we could tell it was online.
I felt he was going to hit it as well because he's just been so clutch. You realize that he is for his career, a 33% three-point shooter.
And that's boosted up with what right. he's done this year. Going into this season, in his time with Utah and Cleveland before he got here, he was a 30.7% is what he was before he got here this year.
Did you say 30.7?
30.7 was his three-point percentage before his arrival with the Mavs. And obviously, as we reported last summer, report is not the right way, as we looked up on Basketball Reference last summer, he shot about 39% in all of his games with FC Barcelona and Partizan in Serbia. He was, counting league games and Euro League games and such, domestic league and Euro League games. He was around 38 to 30, high 38, low 39% on three. So he clearly had gone over there and worked on his game and specifically worked on his shot. And he is going to shoot. He's not going to have enough to qualify because you got to have 82 made threes in a season to qualify for the league leaders in three-point percentage. He's not going to get close to that. He's at 52 right now. But he might shoot on a volume of about 110, 115 three-point attempts. We'll see what it ends up, 50%. The dude's 52 of 103 after yesterday on threes, which is just like a couple of tenths over 50%.
And it's a joke inside the locker room that when he misses one, they're like, well, keep shooting because you're going to make the next one.
You're 50%.
You're 50-50. And it's just so good to have a player like that who can be that third ball handler, last play, bring the ball up the court right after that. I mean, Matt, look what happened last night. This team was down three. It was over.
Yeah.
One free throw was curtains. And P.J. Washington secures the rebound after the second miss. You got a player like Exum, even with Luka and Kyrie on the floor, who can bring the ball up, gets it to Luka. Luka, I don't even think he was thinking about shooting. He was just drawing that double team because he knew he had trust in Exum to go get that shot and nail it. And he was open, wide open, and was, again, because of how well he shoots, was able to nail it. And, that was the backbreaker. I had a feeling then after that, shocking as it was to realize that was the first overtime game the Mavs had played, that Houston wasn't going to have anything left because of that. And, for the second night in a row, you have major plays at the end of the game and the excitement that's building around here. But
I heard Dante after the game yesterday say, P.J. got the rebound. He had a split second. I mean, it's amazing how this all happens, Like, these guys make it look like it's all second nature, but there is, like, a split-second thought process. He was like, should I let P.J. bring it up or should I go get it? He goes, I just went and grabbed it. I went and got it after P.J. rebounded it. And you're right. You're so right. It is so beneficial to have another guy besides Luke and Kyrie that can bring the ball up the floor. And then, Bullock is right there with Exum bringing it up the floor. They work the dribble handoff. The second defender goes to Luka. Luka has the trust in his teammates to make the right basketball play.
And oh, by the way, Exum said, what's the play we're drawing up, kid? And the kid's like, just go.
Yeah. Yeah. There's not necessarily a play that you run in that situation. It's just read, react, and run actions that you run over the course of the game. A dribble handoff is not like some sort of special play. It's an action you run all the time, and it's just an action to get the defense moving, and in this case, suck that second defender into Luka.
Because Luka's been so much better at the three-point line, and he can hit from that distance that he's got to be respected with two players, which opens that shot up, and to have a player who can knock it down. It's just great. And so when I think about all of this, it takes a village, but it also takes a front office. And it really struck me in this Golden State game, because that was a non-Luka game. And we've seen in the past where that can be problematic. Again, that Oklahoma City loss is one of the only, you know, only two losses out of these last 15 or 16 because of not playing with Luka in that game. And I looked at the, I was looking at the starting lineup and a lot of the closing lineup in the fourth quarter, and I was like, these are all new players from the last 14 months.
Yeah.
No one was on this roster.
Yeah, the starting lineup of that game was Exum and Kyrie in the backcourt, Derek Jones Jr., PJ Washington, Daniel Gafford.
So Kyrie
was acquired essentially 14 months ago, February the 5th or 6th of 2023. And then you had an offseason signing of Derek Jones Jr., an offseason signing of Dante Exum.
Oh, by the way, Exum was signed in July from Partizan, okay, from overseas, so not on a ton of people's radar, but they scattered it out on a team-friendly deal where he's
Thank
got
you, Dennis Lindsay, by
Thank
the way.
Thank you, Dennis Lindsay, who was brought in last summer as well as a special advisor. You have a team option. He's going to be on your team next year at a $3 million.
Yeah, at a great number.
Whether that's minimum or just above. Derek Jones Jr., minimum signing. Your last player signed in August or September.
Yeah, August, I think.
That's three players. And then your two trade deadline acquisitions.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's the difference between last year and this year, is that you can survive those kinds of games because you made such smart moves over the last year.
Yes, and as I have to give credit to our old buddy Mike Reiner, longtime host on The Ticket, who back in 1998 when the Rangers made a bunch of moves and got like Royce Clayton and Todd Stottlemyre, and that propelled them to winning the division that year, their second division crown in 1998. Ryan's always referred to that as Doug Melvin's trade deadline day daring do. So that's when we have front office daring do changes the look of the Mavs. And it has been, I think it has been trade deadline day daring do. Just to your point a minute ago, that there were a lot of people who panned. I mean, it's weird. When I brought it up on Twitter the other night, and one person said, well, gosh, what weird trades Washington and Charlotte made. It must be nice that there's collusion going on. And I'm like, that is not what that, like, that is, no one thought that whenever these trades, they were graded by ESPN
as a C+.
And I think one of them was a D. I think one was a C and one was graded as a D. And listen, I think it's okay. I think both things can be true. You can be worried about what the draft ramifications are in the future. I don't think that's crazy to feel that way. But the here and now, of course, is what matters. And finding players who fit the archetype of what need to be the puzzle pieces around Luka and Kyrie. 1 year ago, we were sitting here talking about, can Luka and Kyrie work? And Nico Harrison, the general manager, and everyone who works with Nico in the front office, because it's not just a one-man show. There are a lot of individuals from Andrew Baker and Michael Finley and Matt Riccardi. There are a lot of individuals that are part of that brain trust in the front
office.
Terry Sullivan, thank you very much. That group, they had an idea, and they were very, very committed. Yes, Luka and Kyrie can work. We just didn't have the right guys around them, and we've got to go
and we
out
didn't have
and
the
get
time.
The right guys around them.
And we didn't have the time.
Yeah, and that's what they've done. That's what they've done over the course of their signings.
And when
the
you talk
summer,
about finding the right guys, it is, I'm going to pluck this guy from overseas that I know has the potential to be better than what he is and is rounding into form and is playing better there. I know what Derek Jones can do defensively. In this system with open looks, I think he can provide something offensively. I know what Kyrie can do. We're buying low on that. He's a talent. I've worked with him before. Gafford. That's the prototypical kind of rim-running center I want. Yes, a pick swap is worth that, and I can play that way now for 48 minutes. P.J. Washington, he's underutilized. He's a star in Charlotte.
Yeah.
Put him in our system with what we can do. He can shine to this level.
We're both getting choked up
That's
talking about it.
That's what smart front offices do.
And let me add one other thing to it. We both felt like, and obviously the Mavs felt this way, they wouldn't have done it, that Grant Williams was a good signing in the offseason. And that he was going to grow into a bigger role than what he had in Boston. He would have the opportunity to be a better player and take on a larger role within the flow of the team here. Unfortunately, that didn't work out. Got off to a great start, and then things didn't work out. And by the way, Grant was very open and honest in an interview that he recently did about why things didn't work here and that he probably wasn't ready physically for what they were putting on him and the responsibility they were going to give him. And what I really admire and respect about Nico is he is sure is not caught up in the idea of sunk cost. You know, it's like, okay, we tried this. It didn't work. maybe under normal circumstances, we might be willing to roll with this and give a guy that we just signed to a four-year contract a little bit more time. But no, the time is now. We have a generational talent and another superstar next to him, and we've got to figure out a way to make this work. And so if we can upgrade and make a trade, then we're going to have to be what some people might perceive a little bit impatient with the guy that we signed in the
offseason. He's not stubborn, you know, like you are when you picked Arsenal as your team. You just picked the top team in the league that year.
I didn't do that. They haven't won the league title in 20 years, but they might do it this year.
We're running late, so I do want to give Tim Hardaway some flowers because what he did in the Golden State game towards the end was absolutely essential in terms of the two key assists.
Yes.
Not just one.
Obviously, the main one here.
The last play here. Again, this was not a play that was drawn up. He was going in, and he was wise enough to realize that he sucked that defense in. P.J. Washington said he was coming in for a rebound. Hardaway sees him in the corner diving. Green was coming towards him, who was his man, to provide even more rim protection, and Hardaway makes the great play for what ended up being the game winner.
Yeah. It's look, Tim has been obviously on the radar in a bad way based on the fact that everything has pointed in such an amazing direction since the trade deadline, except his shooting. And obviously that's tailed off significantly, as we know. And, excuse me, Ryan, he's had a couple of nice games along the way, but generally speaking, his shooting numbers have been way down from what we would expect them to be. But
you need Tim Hardaway on this team playing effectively.
Yes, you do. And if you're not going to make shots, and this applies to Tim or any other player, then you just simply have to find a way to help the team in other ways. And the assist that he had in that game, only three, but obviously the key assist and a couple of key assists late. Key rebound along the way.
Huge rebound late.
The
game-saving rebound late.
The Utah road win. Remember that in the fourth quarter of that game, which was Utah led in the fourth quarter of that game, Brian, at the beginning of the last road trip, Tim had key steals. He had several assists.
After a hot start in the fourth quarter that kept him in the game.
Yes, exactly. He didn't make shots in the second half, but he had key defensive plays and key playmaking opportunities, facilitating opportunities in the second half of that game. Nobody wants to be in a slump, and nobody feels worse about it and is harder on himself about it than Hardaway is. He doesn't want to be in a shooting slump, but he did make big play, a very, very big play late in that game that was instrumental to them winning. And we'll see what the playoff rotation looks like. He'll be in it, how much he's going to play. I think a lot of that will be dictated on, you know, each game and what the shot making looks like when he gets out there.
And so this just proves the last two games how well the Mavs have been in the clutch. Remember, after the deadline, they were 5-13 in the clutch last year.
Yeah.
And they have turned it around. They're back to number one in clutch. Run through these for real quick for us.
23-9 in clutch games. Those are designated by the NBA as within 5 points in the final 5 minutes. We came up with the term super clutch for games that are within three in the last 2 minutes. So at some point in the last 2 minutes of the game, you're playing in a game that can be changed by one shot. They're 5-2 in games decided by 3 points or less, which includes the two-point win over Golden State Friday. Yesterday went to overtime, but ended up being an 11-point victory. And then they're 8-10 on field goals to tie or take the lead in the last 30 seconds.
How different is that from last year?
Yeah, I mean, I think, what did we say last week? It was 8-30. They were 8-30 on those shots last year. They're 8-10 now after PJ made a shot the other night to win the game. And then yesterday, Kyrie missed a three with 20 seconds to go that would have tied, but obviously
Seemed like that was the end.
Yeah, which seemed like that was the end. But, look.
And the reason that it's not just fluke, make, or miss. It's that now your two superstars are attracting so much attention that some of the other shots are being open. Those superstars are making those key shots. They have vertical guys that can key shots. You're making smart moves where you're getting little layups to win the game. There's a method to the madness. It's not just randomness of, we just happen to be hitting shots now that we didn't hit last year.
And a component yesterday at the end that put XM in a position is they even go back a few seconds before. They executed a defensive situation the best that you could hope for in that, they tried to get a steal. And they also
almost got a turnover.
Yeah, they got Fred VanVleet up along the sideline, forced him to pass it. And as I said on the telecast, Jabari Smith's an 83% free throw shooter. However, I would much rather have him shooting these free throws. Even though the percentage number isn't great, VanVleet's 86.5%, Jabari Smith's 86, but
Van Vliet's got one of these.
Yeah, Van Vliet's got one of those. He's got a title ring, and Jabari Smith, all due respect to him, is in his second year. And as Harp has pointed out many, many times over the years, the basket shrinks when people go to the line in the fourth quarter. Not for everybody. Not for Fred Van Vliet, probably. Not for Kyrie. Although Van Vliet missed one late yesterday, too. Not for Kyrie Irving.
Shots in the fourth are shots in the first.
Kyrie Irving's 95% with the Mavericks on free throw lines in the fourth quarter. The basket doesn't shrink for him, but for a lot of guys, it does. And, man, you got to – those two free throws by Smith yesterday were not pretty, especially the first one. Second one, too, but especially the first one where it's like, I think Harp said on the broadcast, it's like just all the energy just, like, went out of his arm.
Yeah.
He just.
So we got to give Jay Kidd some credit here as well in terms of his, you know, steady leadership, a lot of good ATOs, a lot of good pulling of the right strings. It's really, you know, he told me after the Sacramento wins, he said, you know, I didn't put too much pressure on this team about these games. These were huge. We had circled these games for a while.
Yeah.
They were big games. And a lot of times you can go in and say, hey guys, like, these are the biggest games of our season. We've got to really buckle down and get this. But he kept them loose. You know, he kept them. And again, loose isn't like, oh, we're just.
Loose is not playing grab ass.
Right.
Yeah.
This is, we're focused. We show up on time. Our cell phones are away. We're doing our work. But it's not anxious and uptight.
Yeah,
we know what we can do when we play our game. We're going to take our info in and do what we're supposed to do and play read and react basketball.
They had a great shoot around that Friday in Sacramento, man.
And
we were there, I was there. It was fantastic.
And
it was,
so
it was loose in the right way and focused in the right way.
And I know we've had conversations with media people are like, why doesn't he have a T to support his team? And he's like, no, I'm showing how you relate to referees. I'm not letting that get into my head. I'm playing the opponent and taking it out on them. And I think we have to give credit to the relationships he has on the team.
The communication.
You know, his scheme defensively against Golden State in that last possession, having the right people out there, switching everything, doing all that. He's got to get some love, too.
Jason has the pulse of this team. He has his finger on the pulse of this team. He truly, truly does. He's immensely respected in the locker room, particularly by, and most importantly, by Luka and Kyrie. You know, it's kind of how we all got this started, talking about those two guys. There's immense respect.
And there's no secret that they are playing their best basketball under him.
Yes, that is absolutely right. And it's really exciting to watch. You know, as I said when talking on the radio to one of those media members that we have talked about, you know, why doesn't he have a technical? It's like, this is who Jason is. We have a 30-year body of work to understand who he is. As a player, he was famous for whenever he was mad about something, the whole jersey over the mouth thing.
The Michael Jordan move.
Yeah, who knows what he was saying under here.
Yes, but you're not showing him up.
You're not showing up to referees. And as we said before, you know, the one of the biggest failings he felt like of this team was getting too caught up and distracted by the referees. So
getting under feels.
What example do you need to show that I'm not going to get all caught up with the referees? But I would also say, if you're watching, you know, you don't see Jason Kidd on every moment of the TV broadcast. If you're at the games and seeing what he does, he's working officials.
Yeah, absolutely.
He is getting pissed off at officials. I think you said in the Oklahoma City game, I wasn't there, but you said you couldn't believe he didn't get a technical because of how hard he went in on a couple of the officials in that game. Maybe he didn't get one because they knew they messed up some of the calls in that game.
And oh, by the way, when he's mad about a call, he's usually right because he's what, third in challenges?
Yeah, behind Billy Donovan and Taylor Jenkins. Yeah.
So, lastly, Mark.
And this is leading in. By the way, Jay Kidd ties into this final point. He's always said that on the best teams, the best players are the leaders.
Real quick before you get into it, it's all started February the 5th. After the Indiana game.
Yeah, March the 5th, Indiana game.
Excuse me, March 5th.
Yeah.
That meeting.
Yeah.
Who was in the meeting? Who spoke at that meeting?
Jason Kidd, among others.
Spoke.
Yeah.
Markieff Morris spoke. A lot of people don't know he's a leader in that room. And Kyrie Irving spoke.
Yeah.
Kyrie Irving showed me his leadership in two ways. One was when Tim Hardaway told me on radio that he got encouragement at a layup line. This was, he talked to me, I think, after the first Sacramento game.
Yeah.
He said, in the fourth quarter of that Utah game, when I wasn't shooting well towards the end, Kyrie said, you keep doing that. We need you.
Yeah.
And he said, that spurred me to keep going and having this great game tonight. And what was the second thing that showed me that he's a leader that has respect? That PJ Washington shot right
here.
Here
it is, right here. So here's the shot. Watch Kyrie in the background. Everybody's celebrating, and Kyrie's going around. One stop. One stop. And
of course, that's it right there.
Yeah. Because that's leadership in a lot of ways. But also, and I even brought this up with Kid yesterday, it is indicative of the fact that one of your superstar players, who is known for his amazing offensive prowess, is as bought in as anyone is on the fact that the thing that's going to put this team over the hump, and you got to have great offense too, but is their commitment and improvement as a group defensively.
That to me is, that's everything. I mean, the two shots of the last week that are really season-long shots for me are the hug and that.
Yeah, and the other thing, by the way, with the Lukai hug yesterday is they're together, and then as we showed in that video earlier,
the team.
Derek Jones gets in there, and then Kyrie is the one signaling, hey, everybody get in here. You know, everybody get in here. And it's just, it is pinch yourself stuff that he is a part. Here's one more look at it. Yeah, he's the guy. Look at that. Yeah, he's got his right arm around Luka and his left arm. Everybody get over here. And it's the young guys, it's the veterans, it's everybody. You know, that's on this team, man.
That is really special stuff. So here is where we're at, Mark.
Yeah.
We're going to join everybody a week from today with a playoff preview.
Yep.
We don't know who it is. We don't know where we're going to be, but we will definitely be here for an extensive playoff preview. And then we'll have special playoff programming that we'll announce next week. But the week ahead is still important. As we mentioned, there's a chance to get to five.
Basketball Reference, by the way, today said it was a 94% chance on their playoff probabilities where they run 10,000 simulations of the season.
Right.
And over 9,400 of their simulations, the Mavericks ended up fifth.
Okay. So we have Charlotte tomorrow night, WFAA.
Yep.
Miami Wednesday night, WFAA.
Correct.
Detroit at the final home game of the regular season, Friday, WFAA.
Correct.
And then Sunday afternoon at 2:30, where everybody's going to play at the same time, I believe, in these games that matter for Dallas.
Yes, yes.
If that matters.
Yeah, decision day.
On the road against Oklahoma City. I'll be on all those pre- and post-game shows. You will be on all those broadcasts. We will be back with you. I'll have a big D Magazine article dropping on Thursday, I believe. So.
Yeah, Charlotte, Detroit are playing out the string. Miami certainly is battling for position. They could get out of the play-in tournament, or they could certainly, you know, be in the most advantageous spot in the play-in tournament, 7. 6, 7, 8, you know, is a good little battle there in the Eastern Conference, and Miami's right in the thick of that. So they've got a lot on their plate. And we'll see what Oklahoma City has. We'll see, you know, if the Mavericks have anything to play for. Hopefully they won't. And we'll see what Oklahoma City has to play for that day.
Well, I'm drained after an hour or two. I think maybe we'll have to walk arm in arm. We'll have to hug each other as we walk out of Studio 41.
I'm drained after 4 games in 4 days, man. I had Sebastian Driussi for Austin FC, 101st minute match winner of a 4-3 game for MLS on Apple TV on Saturday night in Austin.
I was feeling bad for myself because I went to bed at like 10. I was tired last night because I did, you know, a lot of games, a lot of podcasts and radio and all that. But yes, then you kind of had to one-up me by
well, we'll be back next Monday as long as the world doesn't end when the eclipse hits today. You know, I'm sure there's probably some doomsday.
Well, good luck to you for that. I can't wait to hear the report on the Greyhounds and their reaction to it.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Well, as always, great to have you here. Great stuff today, Brian, and we always appreciate our viewers and our listeners.
Yes, thank you to NTTA for sponsoring us. This is Take That With You with Follow on Damaris. Tell your friends. Check out that merch at tpublic.com. Search Take That With You, and we will see you next week with our playoff preview.